Hugo Chávez was the man who changed the relationship between Latin America and the Caribbean. You see, Chávez felt that both regions shared the experience of colonization and also heritage. Heavily influenced by the passion the Libertador Simón Bolívar had of seeing, while Latin America bonded together, the military-trained Chávez pursued what he called the Bolivarian Revolution when he assumed power in Venezuela in 1999. Some of the efforts of this revolution included gaining control of the state-run oil company, which created some controversy and led to strained relations with the United States of America and some other nations.
Any thoughts on Venezuela's President Chavez saying your son is the devil?
Well, I'm tempted to...
Go ahead.
Get it in the ass.
Because of this unfortunate strained relationship, many got to know Chávez through the eyes of those who were not so fond of him. For those who interacted with him, be it briefly, the image portrayed and the man they met appeared to differ. The late president visited St. Vincent and the Grenadines twice, once in 2001 and then in 2007. On his second visit, I had the honor of covering the event, but was not so lucky to have met him personally. Of course, as a journalist, I would constantly encounter different versions of who Chávez was and the logic behind his actions. But as I ventured into this project, what I discovered left me bewildered, guilty, sad, and in many ways humbled that someone so ordinary could have done the extraordinary and touched lives in such an unforgettable way.
Los países que se sumen al ALBA.
Countries that join ALBA.
Nos montaremos pues en el mismo barco.
We will be sharing the same ship.
Nos montaremos en el mismo rumbo.
We will follow in the same course.
Y los países que tenemos mayor extensión territorial, mayores recursos, asumimos mayores responsabilidades.
And it is clear that countries that are bigger and with more resources, we therefore we share more responsibility.
Ahora se sumó Nicaragua el Nicaragua pasado 10 de enero.
In January the 10th has joined ALBA.
Entonces ya el ALBA está Centroamérica.
So in ALBA we have Central America represented.
En el país más grande de Centroamérica.
With the largest, the biggest country in Central America.
Aun cuando el tamaño territorial o la cantidad de habitantes no es determinante para el ALBA.
Even though the size of the territory or the amount of the inhabitants is not a determinant factor within ALBA.
Porque nosotros independientemente de nuestros tamaños, desunidos somos pequeños,
because
unidos somos grandes.
Irrespective of our size, if we are not united, we will not be strong. We need to be united to be strong.
On March 5, 2013, the world was left in shock as the announcement was made of Hugo Chavez's death. You know, in the Caribbean, there's a saying, you never miss the water till the well run dry. I firmly believe this was the case. When the reality struck that Hugo Chavez would be no more, that was when the stories began to be told.
Bueno, yo soy Chávez, todos somos Chávez.
Well, I am Chávez, all of us are Chávez.
Y para nosotros, Chávez está vivo.
And for us, Chávez is alive.
I spoke to some people here who had the privilege of meeting him in person to get a feel of what he meant to them in terms of his legacy and what they understood his passion and dream to be.
Dr. Matthias, you're one of the privileged few who had a chance to be up close and personal with the late President Hugo Chávez when he was here last in 2007. What that felt like?
We were blown away by the fact that President Chávez would leave his busy schedule in Venezuela to come to visit us here at Argyle. We were also delighted that he came to see us because we recognized that the brotherly love that he was sharing, he wanted to bring it to Argyle himself. I myself have met President Chávez in Venezuela, and I saw in him someone who was deeply concerned about the plight of the underprivileged peoples of the region.
You think that was a genuine thing?
I believe so strongly. And his actions also underscored his own determination and commitment to helping people, to improve the lives of the peoples of this region.
I met President Chávez a number of times. The first time I met him was actually in Venezuela. I went there as a lawyer who was helping to craft and negotiate the Petrocaribe arrangement at the time. And we met him at Miraflores, which is sort of the presidential palace. And I didn't expect President Chávez to be there, you know. And when I saw him coming down the hallway, he's a very larger than life character, and I was a little awed by his presence.
Got intimidated a bit?
A little overawed, you know. You see this person on the news, and he's such a presence when he comes into the room. And he was introduced to me, and he put his hand on me, and he said, he has this deep voice. He said, "Hello, Camilo, how are you?" And I thought he could speak English. So I started speaking to him in English, and he said, no. All I know is, "Hello, Camilo, how are you?" So immediately I knew that he had a wonderful personality. He was very warm, he was very engaging, and immediately disarmed you with his charm and with his very good sense of humor.
He hugged up 12 of the workers, he had one on each arm, and he started talking.
To them?
Yes, and well, they actually were translating. He wanted to know how the plant functioned, what this was for, how much cylinders it could do in an hour, in a minute actually. In fact, we do 4 cylinders in 35 seconds. And basically that was it. It was a very brief visit, and then he went over to where they had the ceremony on the other side.
I thought he was a very engaging person. When you break bread with people, you get an idea, a flow, because they're at ease during a dinner conversation. And I felt the sense of genuineness when he was talking about national heroes and what it means and what I thought that we need in order to help to inculcate the spirit of national identity. Because it's one of the issues that I first came to me when I went to Cuba, my first visit to Cuba, how well the Cuban population know their national hero, Jose Martí.
That's true.
Every letter he's ever written, every book that he's ever written, we suffer from the sins of colonialism in that they provided us with nothing on our native population. Now, we were taught that our native population was third class and that you had to learn their history, not our history. And when I served as Minister of Culture, it was my focus, my mission to get our people, our nation, to learn to identify with our people, our First Nation people. And this is what every time I think about him, that's what I remember, these snippets of conversations I've had with President Chávez.
Jomo, if somebody were to ask you, how would you describe Hugo Chávez, or who was Hugo Chávez, what would you say?
Extraordinary.
In what sense?
You know, Che once said that to be revolutionary is to be human. And when you look at the work in the times of President Hugo Chávez, you have to conclude that this man was human. He had that connection with ordinary people. Not simply charisma, but that connection came out of his commitment to people and his effort to use the resources of the state to assist ordinary people. The kind of transformations we have had in education, in providing houses, in helping people with medicine and healthcare. Those are things that make for organic connections. And that's why I think in thinking about President Chávez, I think about Che and Che's court.
Chávez was a president who really meant to give all the help he can to all the countries. And I know that he was very keen to help the Caribbean, this part of the Caribbean, that for some reason or the other, we are not so close to Venezuela before his government. So he was very determined that this Caribbean was going to be very close to Venezuela also. And he was very determined to help and to get closer and to understand better. So that is something that I think that for this part of the world, it's important to remember Chávez.
It was an historic moment for Latin America, and for some, one centuries in the making. 33 countries came together Friday to inaugurate the first organization to include all the nations of the Americas, except for the United States and Canada. Held in Caracas, the summit began not with Venezuelan President Hugo Chávez, making his most high-profile appearance since undergoing treatment for cancer, but with his Mexican counterpart, Felipe Calderón, who evoked the dreams of continental integration first outlined by South America's revolutionary hero.
En la Carta de Jamaica, el gran Simón Bolívar escribía.
In the Carta de Jamaica, the liberator Simón Bolívar said, "What a beautiful idea to mold the new world into a single nation that is linked with a single chain." And today, 2 centuries later, the ideas of Bolívar are still present and relevant for all Latin America and Caribbean people.
The summit brings together leftist and conservative governments with the aim of tackling common challenges like energy, human rights, and security. But for its host, the occasion is first and foremost about regional independence.
Hopefully the governments of the North listen a bit, see a bit, and document a bit what is happening in the South. For example, in Latin America and the Caribbean, we are progressively leaving poverty, misery, as we've closed the gap.
I remember distinctly meeting President Hugo Chávez in April of 2001. It was in Quebec, at the Summit of the Americas, and there was an instant bond between us and between President Chávez and my husband. They bonded instantly and got along like a house on fire. I knew from that day that they were going to be friends. And indeed, they were quite close in the ensuing years. Their friendship deepened.
Quebec City.
What year was that?
April 2001, within weeks of getting elected. In fact, on my first trip outside of the Caribbean after I was elected, that would have been mid-April, April 16th, 17th, thereabouts. The Summit of the Americas in Quebec City, hosted by President Chrétien. You know, I remember when we had the lights on, we had a lighting system, we were in an oval table, and the light would, the green light would come on, you'll have a certain amount of time to speak. Can't remember, it was 5, 7, 10 minutes, everybody. But the lights would come on, green, then it would turn to amber to tell you that it's time to wind up. And then the red comes on. And of course the red came on. And Hugo just went on and on and on. So Chrétien was in the chair. Chrétien says, "Please, President Chávez, the red light has been on for a while." Chávez said, "Oh, didn't realize that. Don't you know I'm colorblind?" I tell you.
Todo esto, Ralph, perdóname que tú me pusiste el dedo ahí en la tecla para reflexionar.
Ralph, you gave me the opportunity to reflect upon all these subjects.
Tenemos que estar en la casa del gobernador. A medianoche llegaremos otra vez a la casa del gobernador.
We are going to talk to the governor at midnight tonight.
Él nos espera, el gobernador.
He will wait for us. Don't worry.
Excelente amigo.
I'll tell them the first time in Quebec City, you know, and we met, and he was
Ralph. My brother. My brother.
George Bush was president. And from at that meeting, he took a strong anti-imperialist position. Of course, reaffirmed, as we know, many of his themes relating to the Bolivarian Socialist Revolution, the importance of the nationalism and the civilization in Latin America and the Caribbean, calling for America to end its criminal embargo on Cuba and for an integration which, for Caribbean and Latin America, which excluded the United States. At the time there was discussion on the free trade area of the Americas. He opposed that and called for an integration arrangement which excluded the free trade area of the Americas, which was being pushed by the United States at the time, and was very sharp in his comments, eloquent as usual.
Simon Bolivar was a charismatic politician and military leader, blessed with a lot of energy. He seemed to have liked singing. While a native of Venezuela, Bolivar had a dream of a united Latin America. More than 100 years later, another charismatic, highly energetic military leader, fascinated with Bolivar and his vision, coined the term Bolivarianism while in the military. Hugo, on stepping into the political arena, quickly got to work in turning Bolivar's vision, dream, into reality, with a stamp of his own, of course. Oh, and a slight observation, he also liked to sing.
Y me sobra hasta el contrario,
como el gallo gallino,
que cuando no gano empato,
es por eso que yo digo,
siempre cuando estoy cantando,
un sombrero como yo,
y si ha nacido está mamando,
yo lo hago parte de la pura voz, hombre,
tan vergatario.
He was heavily influenced by Simon Bolivar and was extremely, I would say, extremely passionate about uniting the Caribbean with Latin America. Do you think he was able to achieve that?
Well, it is. I think he was well on his way. I mean, it was through the force and individual power and charisma and leadership of President Chávez that CELAC community of Latin American and Caribbean countries in the Americas came in. And the position then, that look, we want everybody else except the United States and Canada in. And it was such a significant buy-in that all of the countries agreed to do it. That was his vision, because he so much thought it was critically important for the Americas to be united.
I have been following Hugo Chavez since he and a number of his colleagues in the army sought to mobilize the People's Revolutionary Force when he was, first of all, arrested and jailed. And I followed his career when he came out of jail and won the presidency. And I remember talking to Fidel very early in 2001, certainly September. It was shortly after September the 11th. I went to Cuba, September 11, 2001. I went to Cuba. The visit was arranged in advance. I went there. So it's not because September 11th I wanted to show a position with Fidel in relation to September 11th, because the first person, first leader in the world who came out outside of the United States, that came out strongly condemning the terrorist act on September 11th was Fidel Castro. A lot of people don't remember that. Took a very strong position against terrorism. So too did Chávez. And people conveniently forget that. And Fidel said to me, Hugo Chávez is a very important figure, Ralph, in Latin America and the Caribbean and the world.
He had a mission, which was to bring those millions of people out of poverty, out of the darkness, into the light of enjoying some of the prosperity of their country, and also dealing with the native Indians and bringing them to the forefront, bringing them to the gradually out of the forest to the forefront, so that they can also claim, because they don't just belong to the forest, they belong to Venezuela.
The more involved I got in this, the more I saw the link. Chavez's Bolivarian Revolution was pioneered in 1998. A year later, a new constitution was adopted, replacing the one of 1961. Venezuela was renamed the Bolivarian Republic of Venezuela in honor of Simón Bolívar, who is credited with the 19th century liberation of Venezuela, Colombia, Ecuador, Peru, Panama, and Bolivia from Spanish colonial rule. The Bolivarian philosophy is a form of democratic socialism that rewards nationalism while promoting economic self-sufficiency of the nation. Chávez was seen as a hero, inspired by Bolívar. He aimed to address the social injustices neglected by the elites in Venezuela.
Look, Venezuela since the early years of the 20th century had oil. And for almost 100 years before Chávez came to power, oil was being used to enrich the wealthy and enrich them further. When Chávez came to power, after, okay, let me say 75 years of oil in Venezuela, Venezuela had a poverty rate of 80%. That's the reality. There are places in Venezuela, up to when Chávez came to office, which had never seen a medical doctor or a dentist. These are facts which cannot be disputed. And he transformed all that. He has left a good man in charge of the Bolivarian Revolution, an able lieutenant who has grown in stature immensely since his election.
If you were to emulate something from him, something pertaining to his character, what would it be?
He had this overwhelming desire to always follow the Constitution. He was always, I remember him giving me a copy of the Constitution. He carried it in his breast pocket. It was no bigger than this. It's a little tiny book. I have it at home as in his breast pocket. And when he went to Parliament, he handed one of his little ones. I still have that.
Haiti and Venezuela has a very, very, very tight relationship. Simón Bolívar was living in Haiti and then traveled to Venezuela to free Latin American country. But I must tell you, we were the first country to provide in our national budget funding for the liberation process. So our president at that time, President Alexis Petro, had in the national budget some funding for the liberation of Latin America. So President Chávez took all those links and then put them together to say Haiti is one of the best partners of Venezuela. And before he died, he always say Haiti will remain one of the best partners, and then it will not, or I can say, you know, I'm not English speaking totally, but it will not leave Haiti alone.
We here in St. Vincent have benefited through one. We have the one laptop per child initiative, the low income housing scheme, scholarships. VINLEC, of course, have gotten a lot of assistance from Venezuela. We have also the power plant at Lomans Bay, and there's so much more. I remember just some years ago, we had through the Ministry of Agriculture, I can't remember the exact amount, but we had, I think it was about 300 pregnant sheep that they sent to St. Vincent, and Vincentians have benefited. A lot of them today have offspring from these, from that program.
Alba, as you know, was his vision to make sure that we in the Americas become closer, because we were taught again to Latin America is Latin America, the Caribbean is the Caribbean, when in fact it is our hemisphere. And we have to rediscover that this is one area, and we mustn't be allowed to be carved up as we were carved up 200 and 300 and 400 years ago among superpowers, and that the people must be united.
And what I saw in this fairly diminutive figure was a very determined person to do what he said he was going to do. And I think courage and determination are important traits that anybody who wants to achieve something significant must nurture within themselves.
And that spirit and that zeal and that evangelism. History is going to record Chávez as the most extraordinary figure the Caribbean and Latin America to have thrown up after the rise of Fidel. This man, Hugo Chavez.
Why you say
that? His vision for the unification of Latin America and the Caribbean, and his insistence that we all use our resources and combine the resources for the upliftment of people. Chavez loved people, not in a mass. He loved people individually. And you would see how he related to people, the genuine warmth, the genuine love, the individual cases of generosity, people he looked out for, in addition, of course, to the solidarity between nations.
The commitment that you hear from other leaders, it was profound and deep. And this was a transformative leader. And I mean, he went away from us much, much, much too soon. And he could have had, we really need another 12 years minimum of a Hugo Chávez. And for him to depart at 58, it's a tremendous loss, not only to Venezuela, but to all of the Americas. Whenever there's a leader who attempts to change the world, you have to do certain things. And that causes a disalignment with what is there. You are toppling sometimes hundreds, centuries of years of socialization, which says that the ordinary man should be in his place. And when you have leaders like Fidel Castro, or Hugo Chavez, Milka Cabral, Muammar Gaddafi, you immediately get a pushback which says, well, these people are not good for you. And I always say to people that when you hear that, you have to look objectively at how are these leaders, how are these movements impacted on your own social life. And if your social life is being impacted on positively, then you have to conclude, well, if this man is the devil, or if this man is a dictator that people are telling me that he or she, this person is, then this person is someone I should embrace.
A leader like Hugo Chavez is once in a generation, maybe more, maybe once in a lifetime. Not that countries don't, individual states don't have powerful and effective leaders, but only occasionally do you have a leader whose leadership and whose charisma transcends their national borders. So you can have a leader who is a great leader within the borders of your country, but very few leaders are able to lead other leaders and to exude an influence that is outsized. And you know, Nelson Mandela was a leader of that caliber. Fidel Castro was a leader of that caliber. But they don't come along very often. They don't come along very often. So the integration movement lost its driving force. But I think that while he is gone too soon, President Chavez was wise enough to institutionalize certain arrangements to take this momentum forward. CELAC is the community of Latin American and Caribbean states, is the brainchild essentially of Hugo Chavez. And he has taught people to appreciate what is possible with unity.
Anyone who sees the Argyle International Airport would in some way remember Chavez. He was instrumental in the equipment that we have. Venezuelans may not be seen as much as the Cubans, warm body on the ground, but in terms of the cost of carrying the airport, Chavez has given significant help in that area. The Petrocuri program, the fuel for energy, which we utilize, Chavez has a significant hand in that. The low-income and no-income housing program of government, Chavez has significant input in that, assisting in getting homes for the poor. The arrangement to educate Vincentians. We have close to 40 Vincentians currently in Venezuela. It's not only the training, but being able to bring the Caribbean closer together to make us bilingual. We can now speak Spanish fluently, develop relations. To me, integration is people to people, the average man. It's not government, it's people. When a Vincentian returns, he or she has friends in Venezuela because they have lived there for the past 3 or so years. So they develop that people-to-people relationship. Bilingually, they can speak Spanish, and that type of integration to me is critical.
Mirando el mapa.
Well, I look at the map.
Y ubicándonos.
And I try to locate ourselves there.
En este territorio.
In this territory.
Territorio que ya decía Ralph.
And Ralph already said.
Él nos recordaba y anoche nos hablaba de Chatoyer.
Reminding us yesterday
Joseph
night
Chatoyer.
About Joseph Chatoyer.
Héroe de esta tierra.
A hero of this land.
Claro, no hay héroes individuales.
It is clear that there are no individual or lonely heroes anywhere.
El verdadero héroe es el colectivo.
A true hero is part of a collectivity, of a group of people.
After my journey into the world of Hugo Chavez, I think I can agree with most of the notion, based on the conversations that I have had and the things I read and learned, the late Hugo Chavez was sort of a politician who comes along once a generation. Having had the opportunity to visit Venezuela a few weeks ago, it is amazing that even in death, this man's life commands a sort of respect that maybe can be seen as reverence, and I understand why.
Chavez, very good. Ya yo voy a terminar porque tengo que ir.
I have to leave now anyway. I'm going to finish.
Pero solo dejo esas reflexiones del alma.
I just want to leave behind me these reflections for you.
Unamos el Caribe de nuevo.
Let's get the Caribbean united again.
Y hagamos la gran nación Caribe.
And let's build the great Caribbean nation.
Ana Karina Rote. Gracias. Thank you.
President Chávez, look deep into the future and realize oil prices will rise higher. He said that wouldn't do. Here's what I'll do for you. One stable price, all the